huge area where God has given us to go in and to be light and to be His truth. And I'm very thankful for the coaches here who have done that, because they get it. They understand these boys who are here today, by God's grace, will be the leaders of the church tomorrow. And just as Jesus commanded people to not shun the small children, but to bring them close in, these coaches are doing that.
Yeah.
And they're going out and they're bringing people to Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Yesterday, Coach John actually asked people to give their lives to Christ. And some of the boys stood up and gave their lives to Christ. That's exactly what we should be living for. We should be shouting for joy when that happens, because the angels in heaven are. When one small child gives his life to Christ, that's worth a whole lifetime of work. More than money, more than clothes, more than fine cars. These coaches have decided not to pursue other things, but to pursue the highest thing, which is Jesus Christ, and sharing His love with small children. So please, continue to support them, and thank you for giving the opportunity to change lives by us using your facility, your fields, and your resources. Thank you very much. If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to James 2. James 2, chapter 14. James 2, verse 14. When I was asked to speak, I was asked to speak on love and what it looks like to live in love. And I was thinking through what that looked like. John, I think 4 is a wonderful passage. You should look at it after church today. John 4 talks about what it looks like to live in love. But I want to take a look at James 2. So I'll read through James 2, verse 14. Faith and peace. What good is it, my brothers, if a man claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such a faith save him? Suppose a brother or a sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to him, "Go, I wish you well, keep warm and well fed," but does nothing about his physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself is not accompanied by actions and is dead. But someone will say, "You have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by what I do." You believe that there is a God. Good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. You foolish man, do you want evidence that faith without deeds is useless? Was not our ancestor Abraham considered righteous for what he did when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? You see that his faith and his actions were working together, and his faith was made complete by what he did. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and he credited it to him as righteousness. And he was called God's friend. You see that a person is justified by what he does, and not by faith alone. In the same way, was not even Rahab the prostitute considered righteous for what she did when she gave lodging to the spies and sent them off in a different direction? As the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead. Sometimes this is somewhat of a passage that people argue with about, because it talks about deeds. And we believe that we are saved through Jesus Christ by faith alone. There is nothing that we can do to earn God's grace except to admit that I am a sinner and Jesus Christ loves me. As I shared with you a little bit, I'm going to introduce my story a bit as I share this. I grew up in Nigeria, southern Nigeria. And I went back to the United States when I was 3 years old. I was saved as a Christian when I was 5 years old, but it didn't really mean too much to me until I returned to Nigeria when I was 7. I went up to boarding school to Jos when I was in, SS or JS1, and that's where my faith really started to pick up. My coach was actually one of the greatest influences in my life that showed me what it means to walk with Jesus and to know Him. My question today to you is, what do you think of when you think of love? For some of you, you may think of a boyfriend. Some of you may think of a girlfriend, maybe a husband, a wife, the relationship of a mother with a small child, or the relationship of a brother and sister. Those are all examples of love. But the greatest example of love ever is Jesus Christ and what He did for us. That Jesus Christ, the creator of the whole universe, would humble Himself to the point of coming and serving among us, living and dying for us, is the greatest example of love that we have. And so now what is our response to that? How do we go out and live in an understanding of what Jesus has done for us? I think James 2 gives us a good example of that. How many of you people know someone who has made a promise but hasn't fulfilled it and said, okay, I'll give you this another day, but when you come to ask for it, they're not there? Or think about a football player. If I came to you and I said, I played football in England for 10 years. I said, I'm a very good striker. I can go out and score 10 goals. You put me in the match, and I run up and I pick up the ball with my hands and I throw it and I start shouting, yay! You guys get confused.
Yeah.
What is this fool doing? Doesn't he know how to play football? And that's kind of the same thing that many times we do as Christians. We come to church, we pray, we're very quick to give maybe offerings, and we say, we love Jesus, we love other people, but then we go outside and we abuse someone. We don't love them. When we see a need, we don't fulfill it. When we do that, we don't only shame our name, but we shame the name of Jesus who we represent. And that's something very serious to think about. That Jesus Christ has given us His name as Christians. Jesus Christ has given us His mission to go and love people. And we quickly say with our mouths, I love you, I care about you. But then we do nothing. This is not the way it should be. And this is what James is saying. That if we just act, just say things, we just say we have faith, but we do nothing, our faith isn't worth very much. And we need to ask ourselves, are we really walking with God? If you look at the first few verses, he asks the question, what good is it, my brothers, if a man claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such a faith save him? He talks about a brother and a sister having needs. As Christians, maybe you go and you see your brother doesn't have clothes, he doesn't have food that day. If you just bless him and say, hi, I'm sorry, hey, yeah, it's hard to be you, and you just walk away from him, that is not living in love. Or you see a small child suffering along the side of the road, and you walk away from him, that is not love. God has called us to support and minister to widows and orphans. God has called us to serve the least of these. And when we choose to walk away from that, we choose to walk away from what God has called us to do. It's not enough, as he says, to simply say with our mouths, Jesus is Lord, but never live it out. Just like a football player who grabs the ball with his hands and goes in and thinks he scored. What would happen? Would referee blow the whistle, tell him it's a foul, and send him back to his side? He wouldn't have accomplished anything. And we don't want to do that. I don't want to get to the end of my life and have Jesus Christ tell me, you missed it. You missed what I called you to do. Meanwhile, the whole time I thought I was doing what Christ called me to do. By no means do what we do save us. If I give a small child water, that does not mean that I've earned credit with Jesus Christ, but it should be an expression of my love for him. It should be just an outward pouring of it. That I love Jesus so much that I'm going to serve these people. I love Jesus so much I'm going to use my own money to pay for my friend who can't go to the hospital. And that is not that we are earning our grace, because grace is free. Grace comes through Jesus Christ and grace saves. But grace also should make us so happy, so full of Christ loving us, that we go out and we pour and we're happy to give because of what Jesus Christ has done for us. He goes on and he talks about Abraham. He talks about his deeds. If you guys remember the story of Abraham, Abraham sometimes had no trouble believing. He went out and he had an extra marital affair with his wife's servant because he was afraid that God wouldn't answer him. He tried to do things his own way. But God actually gave him a son, his one true son, with an old woman, with Sarah, who was past childbearing years. There's no reason why God should have done that. But God gave him that one chance. If Abraham would have said to God, I believe you, take my son, do what you want with my life, and just sat at home, I think we would have questioned whether Abraham really believed that God would save him through his son. But instead, Abraham took his son, went to the altar, laid his son on the altar, was ready to kill his son, and God said, stop! I have a bigger plan. That is faith. That is Abraham's faith in action. The two go together. We can't have them separated. can't just have actions, we can't just have faith. The two go together as a wonderful painting. Even they talk about Rahab the prostitute. By no means is that saying that prostitution is correct or sin is correct. But she showed a change in the pattern when she let those spies come into her house. When she said, I believe that there is a God, and I'm willing to do what it takes to serve Him. So we see God has given us a wonderful mission. God has given us an opportunity to go out and to love and to care about what God has done for us. And it should be an overflowing. We should be so thankful for what God has done in our lives that we love other people, that we give to other people. So let's have our love not simply be something that we talk about, that we hide inside. Let it be an expression to other people. If you can turn quickly with me in your Bibles to Matthew 22. Matthew 22, and we're going to look at verse 34. I'll start reading from verse 34. This is where the Pharisees came to Jesus, and they're trying to stop him. It says, hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question. Jesus, teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? They were trying to get Jesus in the corner. They were trying to use all their human knowledge to trap him. But Jesus saw what they were doing and he overlapped that. He said, the greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, and with all your soul. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and all the prophets hang on these two commandments. The Pharisees loved laws. They loved human explanations for things. They had over 600 laws that they had made, and they were trying to make Jesus pick from them. Jesus sums it up in two commands. Love God and love other people. Our relationship with Jesus Christ, our horizontal relationship with Jesus Christ, must translate to horizontal, to relationships with your brothers, your sisters, your mothers, your children. This is what it truly looks like. If you do not understand this concept of love, if you're confused by what it means to look and to love other people, I would ask you, do you know Jesus Christ? Do you know His love? Because all love is confused apart from Jesus Christ. He is the reason we wake up every day. He's the reason that we have the ability to go out and to care about other people. If you don't know Jesus Christ today, I beg you, please talk to the Reverend. Talk to some of the coaches here. Talk to the people on my team. Because that is the greatest thing that you can ever do with your life, to know the love of Jesus Christ and His forgiveness of our sins. And once you know that love, it cannot stay there. It must go out to everyone, so that people in the community, people even in your church, can see what Jesus Christ has done and can ask, I want to know that. Show me your Jesus Christ. Let me grow in Him. My final prayer for this church is Paul's prayer that's found in Ephesians 3. If you can turn there, that will be the final prayer I have for you today. Again, this is Paul's prayer to the Ephesians in Ephesians 3. I read from verse 14. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom His whole family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of His glorious riches, He may strengthen you with power through His Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, catch that, in love, may have power together with the saints to grasp how wide and how long and how high and how deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses all knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to Him who is able to do immeasurably more than we can ask or imagine, according to His power that is at work within us, to Him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Let's bow in a final word of prayer. In Jesus' name. Oh Lord, thank you for what you've done for us. Jesus Christ, thank you that you came and you died for our sins. Thank you, Jesus, that you have made us new creations in you, and that, God, we do not have to be afraid of the evil that comes to destroy. God, whether that's another person, whether that's Boko Haram, whether that's lack of food, Jesus Christ, we can love because you have loved us. Father, let's go from this service as servants to you, not seeking our own gain, not seeking to put ourselves above other people, but God, seeking to make your name known to the lowest and to the highest. God, you are worthy of all our praise. You are good, you are mighty, you are awesome. Father, may we not leave this place selfishly or thinking about ourselves, but God, make us focus on the world. Make us focus on serving you. And Father, may we live in love and serve you this day. I commit this congregation to you. God, may they continue to be a blessing. May you continue to use them to spread your word and your love to this community and to the rest of Nigeria. Thank you for who you are and for what you continue to do in us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.